Here we have a block of mass M at the top of a 2 meter long ramp. It's released from rest and slides down the ramp. How fast will it be going when it gets to the bottom? So it's going to be here, and we want to know what is V equal to. Okay, so I'm saying use the concept of conservation mechanical energy because we want to demonstrate that concept here. We do know that we probably could have found the acceleration. Yes, we have all the necessary stuff to find acceleration, and we could have used kinematics with the acceleration to figure out how fast it was going after traveling 2 meters. I will remember that if I use conservation of energy, an important concept is the height. So if I put where it is right now, and I say this is h equals zero, that makes sense. H equals zero is when it comes down here. I need to know what this is. Well, if I do 2 times the sine of 30, I get that this is 1 meter. So that's useful to know that it starts off at a height of 1 meter. Okay, what else do we know? Oh man, there's friction. If there's friction, that means I have to find the work done by friction. Because that's non-conservative work done along the way. That messes things up. I'm going to draw a free body diagram right here. Remember, 9.81m is straight down. Because the movement is down the ramp, I'm going to use a reference frame where x is this way and y is this way, because I want to know about the motion in the x and in the parallel and perpendicular directions. I know that these are all my forces. I've got fk here, I've got n here. I don't want to use w anymore. That's wy, and this is going to be wx. And this is 30 degrees. That diagram's putting a bit messy, so I'll write some things down below here. I want to know what, to get friction, I need to know what N is. Well, N is equal to Wy, because those are the only two forces in the new Y direction. And that is equal to W times the cos of 30. So if I do W times the cos of 30, I get 8.496. M. Notice that M is the mass, the unknown mass still. And from that I can get Fk equals mu k times N. That's equal to 0.25 times 8.496 m. So friction is going to be equal to 2.124 m. Again, m isn't meters there, it's the mass. Okay, so we have this idea that there's conservation of energy, and we have a conservation of energy, of mechanical energy formula that can take into account that a non-conservative force messes with things along the way. That should have been a one. So, kinetic energy at the beginning, oh wait a minute, it wasn't moving, it's released from rest, so that's okay. But it did have potential energy at the beginning. And for work non-conservative, remember, if it's friction, which is what it's basically going to be for our situations, it's negative Fk times d, because friction is opposite the motion it's going to go. At the bottom, it's going to have kinetic energy, so 1/2 mv2 squared. But if it's at the bottom, it's going to be at a height of zero. So there's not going to be any potential energy anymore. So m is just m. G is 9.81, H1 is 1. Let's see, what do we have for Fk? Fk is negative 2.124m, and then we have to multiply that by the distance. The distance is going to move. Remember, friction, the work done by friction is done by calculating this force. How much work does it do as it has this movement? Well, the force is opposite the movement. The object's going to go down the ramp. So that's why we have a negative there. And we're going to take this negative 2.124 meters and multiply it by the parallel displacement, parallel but opposite, by the 2 meters that it travels. Equals 1/2 of, what do we have here? M. Right, we don't know what M is. V2 squared. Oh, I got to that point again where I see an M in every term. So if I were to divide this by m, and this by m, and this by m, I would notice that it would divide out and just become 1 in every single one of them. So now I just have 9.81 times 1 and negative 2.124 times 2. 1/2 V2 squared. So how about we subtract those two, multiply them by 2, and square root it, and we will get 3.34 meters per second equals V2. So that's how fast it's going to be going when it gets to the bottom, 3.34 meters per second. Now we have a ski jumper who pushes off the top of a ski ramp. This is what ski jumpers do. They want to give themselves as much energy as possible to get a good jump. And one thing they can do is start off with a little bit of kinetic energy by giving themselves a little bit of push at the top of the ramp. That push gives her initial speed of 4 meters per second. She slides down the ramp without pushing along the way, so she's not exerting a force along the way. What's making her go faster and faster is gravity until she gets to here, and then she slows down again as gravity slows her down, or we like to think of that as she starts with a lot of potential energy, and as she goes down, that potential energy is converted to kinetic energy, and then as she goes up again in order to do that jump, some of that kinetic energy is turned back into potential energy. But the other thing is, along the way, there is going to be friction, so there is going to be a non-conservative force along the way. So what we have here is K1 plus U1 plus the work done by the non-conservative force is equal to K2 plus U2. 1/2 MV1 squared plus MGH1 plus the work done by this non-conservative force, let's call it WF because it's the work done by friction in this case, as it's going to be in most cases, but not always. That's kinetic energy plus MGH2. And none of those things are zero, so we'll just start putting some values in. What do we know about this? We know that her mass is 65, and V1 was 4. Here we have 65 again, times 9.81, and H1 was 73. Plus the work done by friction that we're looking for is equal to 1/2 of 65, times she goes off the ramp at 25 meters per second, but 65 times 9.81 times her height at the end, 12, gives us the potential energy at the end. So her kinetic energy at the end was 520, if I multiply that out. Her potential energy was 46548. And a lot more potential energy than kinetic energy there, but I guess every little bit of kinetic energy helps. Equals 1/2 of 65 times 25 squared is 2312 joules, and 65 times 9.81 times 12 is 7652 joules. So she started off with this much total mechanical energy, and she ended up with that much total mechanical energy. It's pretty clear to me that there was a lot more at the beginning because this work of friction did negative work, taking away some of that energy, turning it into heat so that the total amount of energy at the end was less, the total amount of mechanical energy. So I'm just going to add up the two things on the right side and then subtract this and subtract this from get them from that side. And I find out that I get negative 191.04 joules, which is, you know, big and has a lot of sig figs. So let's just change that to kilojoules, which means moving the decimal place back 3. And then we can just keep negative 19.1 kilojoules, 3/6 is fine. And that seems to be a good answer. Negative again, because it did negative work. Friction was working against the motion.